I'm pleased to have with me United States Senator Joe Manchin, and we're glad to have you with us today, Senator.
Good to be with you, Auditor.
You know, I had the opportunity to work with you for 6 years as governor and 4 years before that as Secretary of State, and we won't go back into the time in state Senate and how many years it kind of dates both of us. But Senator, I know when you went to Washington, you went in a spirit of working cooperatively with everyone, and that's the way you governed here as governor. You worked bipartisanly, you reached across the aisle on every issue to try to build consensus. You've always been a consensus builder. How has that been moving to Washington as a United States Senator and attempting to do that?
It's a little more challenging. Politics is at a higher level, if you will. I mean, it's all about if you're an R or you're a D, Republican or Democrat. And basically, it's not sometimes the most bothersome thing to me is it's when you see a problem, which we have, in getting our financial house in order for this nation, you would think that would bring all of us together. But people are more guarded because they're saying, well, if I do this, it might make this look better or make this person or this party look better than the other. And that's where you have to come together as Americans. We did it as West Virginians. We'd put our state above our self-interest or our party politics. And I think our state's in better shape because we've done that.
Right.
We didn't look at it, well, you're a Republican or you're a Democrat and you might get more credit than me, so I'm not going to do anything. We just said, let's fix it because the best politics is good government. When I first got to the Senate, I had to realize I'm now in a legislative role, not the executive role, as coming from governor. So you start looking for allies. And Mark Kirk, a senator from Illinois, a Republican senator from Illinois, we just hit it off. We talk, it made a lot of sense. He come from a coal-producing state, Illinois. I'm a coal-producing state, West Virginia. We had a lot in common. So we were both freshmen together, and we started saying, well, let's maybe we can have a bipartisan lunch every Thursday. We'll meet at 12. Mm-hmm. We started that. And we get a few senators from time to time, a few Democrats, a few Republicans. We'd sit down in the old Senate dining room, and we'd talk about things. One time, Mark and I were talking, and we saw the alarming figures of our veterans who are unemployed. And beyond unemployed with all the problems they are returning and how many are coming back. And the more we kept checking into it, we said, we need to do something. So we started a Veterans Jobs Caucus, basically just directed towards how do we help men and women coming back that have served and willing to sacrifice their life for us, how do we get them back into mainstream? And we thought, well, we'll say we'll hire veterans. So we started this procedure of it's pretty simple. Mm-hmm. It's I hire veterans. Mm-hmm. That's all it is. And we have people talking and showing their, they show their patriotism in so many ways. Yellow ribbons, remember the Yellow Ribbon
right.
campaign? You remember we all proudly fly our flags? But if you truly are patriotic, then you should be making every effort to hire a veteran. I know you have many veterans mm-hmm. in your office. I know most state offices do. Well, in the Senate, we started looking, you know, and there were 29 of us that started this caucus within a six-week period. Our goal is to get all 535 members of Congress, 435 in the Senate, 100 in the, 435 in the House, 100 in the Senate, because it's hard to go out and ask businesses that you should be hiring a vet and making every effort when we don't practice what we preach.
Right.
I'm very proud to have, I have three veterans in my office, and they're unbelievable workers. So we just figured out what's happening. Why have we not connected? Why are there so many veterans? And let me give you the figures that Glenn are just mind-boggling. Since September 11, 2001, the figures that I've been shown show that we have over 777,000 unemployed veterans just from that period of time.
Wow.
West Virginia has 6,000. Now these are people that are well-trained, they're disciplined, they have good work ethics. They should be the first person you're looking for to come back into the workforce. And there's so many agencies that are working so hard to help them, mm-hmm. but nobody connected the dots. So we thought, well, as U.S. senators, if we can bring visibility to this cause, and it'll then start bringing people together, and that's what we're doing. We started last week, as you saw, it was a big breakout or a big blitz that we had. We had a tremendous amount of people from all walks of life, from the hierarchy of the Joint Chiefs of Staff all the way to the front office of the Defense Department. And we're committed to working together, so we're asking you to take a leadership position in the state to make sure that every state office, and if they are hiring, proudly present this and try to hire even more. We're asking the businesses that have veterans working, put this up and I guarantee you'll get more business. Mm-hmm. We're going to brand this nationwide. And when you see this, you know you're talking to an organization or a government entity that's truly patriotic. The big thing, Glenn, we saw that we're trying to get one website, and we're working on that now, that if you're a government, let's say you're your auditor's office, and you're going to say, you know, I'd like to have a good veteran. Mm-hmm. You'll be able to look on this website and see someone that wants to come back to West Virginia is going to be what separating or mustering out, as we used to call it, within 6 months. And you're going to say, they've got some skill sets that they were clerical. They got things that really work for me, financial backgrounds, whatever it may be. And I'm going to contact that person and tell them I'd like to interview them. We're not, you follow me, we just right. haven't gotten, with technology today, we should be able, and the military said, they'll let us start being informed about as soon as possible when a person is going to be cycling out mm-hmm. and when they want to come back into civilian life. We're going to have different entities, such as government entities, retailers, manufacturers, home builders, whatever, that have signed up for this. And if a person says, I want to go back to the Southwest, I'm from Missouri, well, fine. Everyone in Missouri that's on that list says, I'm needing a heavy operator. Someone's had experience with cranes, and I know they've been disciplined, they've been well trained, and they come from the military. That's where I want to go.
Right, right. Yeah. So. Yeah. Well, you know, that's one thing about the folks in the military, and as you said, I've got several veterans that work for me. They understand how to get the job done and an order, and they carry it out. It's not, well, it's 5 o'clock, I'll do it tomorrow. I've always found they get the job done, no matter how long it takes.
And the loyalty. I mean, they're yes. there for the right reason. They, really they come to work, and they come for the right reasons. They've been trained that way. They've been disciplined, mm-hmm. You know, to do the right thing and get the job done. So. They have a lot of attributes, and you would think naturally that the first person you would look at, if you saw, well, I've got three applications, this one's a veteran, that should be where I go first. Mm-hmm. So we just figured out, we just hadn't connected. There's a lot of agencies that are working hard, mm-hmm. but these numbers are, unemployment rates is about a little over 8%, 8.3, 8.5, okay, in the United States of America.
Right.
The veterans average is over 12%.
Wow.
Let me give you this number, which really upsets me more than any. Males. So a male that's done 2 years or so of service, they're between 18 and 24 years of age, that's the category age-wise. Mm-hmm. Their unemployment rate, the young male coming out of the Army or Navy or Air Force, is over 29% unemployed.
Oh my gosh.
Now something's wrong.
Yeah.
Something is desperately wrong. And we as Americans, I mean, you know, these wars are out of sight, out of mind. If it wasn't for the National Guard, half of us, or the majority of Americans wouldn't even know there were conflicts around the world.
That's right.
Because of the basically professional services that we have today. When I was many, many years ago, and many people in my age, you know, we were drafted. So everybody was involved.
Yep.
And but today, you know, it's an all-volunteer army.
It is.
And a military. Except for the National Guard. And the National Guard, basically, you see your aunt, your uncle, your mom, your dad, your brother, your sister. These are real people that live with you every day. Now they're being deployed mm-hmm. one and two and three times. So it makes these wars are real.
Yep,
and we have a lot more unrest in Africa and Northern Africa and East Middle East. It's just unbelievable what's going on with Syria today. I met with people that are concerned about the absolute inhumane treatment of people in Syria. And we've got it, you know, as Americans, I mean, we've been a leader for the free world in the humane treatment, and you cannot tolerate genocide anywhere in the world. So you have to build those coalitions. We see that going on. We have Iran mm-hmm. in a very unstable situation, Afghanistan. Pakistan is not anywhere close to being what we would call a good ally. Yeah. We just have a lot of problems going on around the world, but, you know, it starts right here. We have to keep ourselves strong.
As a member of the Armed Services Committee, where do you see the future of the U.S. military going? You know, you just talked about all the issues and the hot spots in the world, and that yeah. list is going to grow daily.
Yeah.
But, well, you know, and our military is being taxed more and more, and ultimately our National Guard that we see here in West Virginia, the 130th Air Wing lift seems like they're going somewhere in the world virtually every week.
The thing that I'm concerned about when I look at the whole spectrum, since 9/11, and I'll give you some comparisons of figures. Our military budget, Department of Defense, was a little over $315 billion. Today, we're well over $700 billion, our defense budget. We've spent upwards of $1 trillion or more in Iraq and Afghanistan, almost $600 billion in Afghanistan today. So the amount of money is absolutely enormous, and I don't see an awful lot of good. Occupation or nation building is not something we do and do well. Mm-hmm. Our mission should have been a war on terror. That's what we all thought it was. You get in, get the job done. We got Osama bin Laden. We'll get you. If you're a terrorist and you mean to do harm to America or Americans, we're coming after you. Mm-hmm. But going into these countries trying to change the culture is not, I don't believe, our mission. So with that, we have to get that right. Let me tell you the disproportionate growth in the Department of Defense. We have today more people that are on the payroll of the Department of Defense that are civilians than men and women in uniform. In Afghanistan, as I speak to you today, we have about 90,000 troops, men and women, military troops in uniform. We have 113,000 civilians, or contractors, if you will. So you start questioning, what are we really doing? Over $350 billion of that $700 billion goes for contractors. I think that's a direction that's wrong for this country. Mm-hmm. And why it has grown to that proportion, I can't tell you. Everyone will give you their reasoning and try to defend it in some fashion. But I have simply said this, whatever we did, that was a mistake. We should get back now. And when they talk about cutting the defense, they start playing politics.
Right.
Oh, well, if you're in favor of cutting the defense, then you're not strong military. You're not a strong patriot. You're not protecting. You want to keep America safe.
Right.
That's the furthest thing from the truth. I think that we can cut the Department of Defense and strengthen men and women in uniform, strengthen the National Guard for the support role, but take the high-priced contractor out from the middle. Because what we're having is soldiers of fortune right now, and I see them all the time. I asked the question, I'll see six or eight of them going through the line at the airports. And they're in civilian clothes, but they have backpacks all identical, so I know who they are. And I always stopped to talk to them. I said, where are y'all going? Well, we're going to Afghanistan, either Kandahar or Helmand. They're going down the front lines. So I know they're out there fighting right side by side. The first thing that brought my attention, I have to back up. I went back again in February as a U.S. Senator. I was there in 2006 as a governor, thanking our National Guard troops for the work they do. Then I come back as a U.S. Senator. So I get a little different perspective. But what had happened when I sat and talked to some of them, I'd asked, how many tours? This is my second tour. When do you get out? Well, I'll be out in 8 months. Mm-hmm. Are you going to reenlist? No. What are you going to do? I'm going to go back and work for that private contractor. See that guy right there? He makes three times what I make. And he used to do what I did. So the money has lured them. Right. I ask them all when I see them in the airports, I said, how many of you are ex-military? About 100%. So we were all in the military. Mm-hmm. And then I asked the following question. If we did not have, and if we weren't contracting with these companies you're working for now, and there was no job there to be had, would you have reenlisted and stayed in the military? Probably 80 to 90% says, probably so. Mm-hmm. So something's wrong. It's gotten out of whack.
Right.
And our cost has ballooned. So when they said, can you cut the Department of Defense? Yes, you can. Can you keep the military strong? Absolutely. But as soon as you hear someone talk about cutting, they say, oh, we're going to cut 100,000 troops out. Why don't you cut 300,000 contractors out?
Right.
You follow me? And let's get back to supporting the troops. So are we going to get back? I just talked to one of the undersecretaries of the Department of Defense, and I've asked for some figures that I want to see what's going on. But they know that we're not going to stop.
Right.
Because I just believe that to do what we're doing today and continue with the demands that will be made on the United States of America. We have the technology. We have the drones. We have the different weapons if you need to be able to help people around the world that are seeking freedoms. On the other hand, we need to bring our service personnel. We need to bring our talent and our resources. We can't continue to try to build a nation that doesn't want us there and spend money we can't afford. We should be spending it in America, rebuilding America, keeping America strong, but helping defend the world where we can and where we're asked to come.
Yeah. You know, as governor, you had to deal with the base alignment, realignment issue, the BRAC Commission. And you fought very hard with then Senator Byrd and, of course, General Tackett and General Hoyer. Going through that, how's that helped you now as a member of Armed Services and understanding, one, the importance of the Guard to the state, but also the importance of the Guard to the military and the big picture?
Well, first of all, you know, what was so easy, General Tackett, now General Hoyer, they made it so easy because the people they put around them and the results they received, they were recognized as the best National Guard unit in the nation. Mm-hmm. In our deployment, in our operation, and also our recruitment, everything we did was top notch. Mm-hmm. I went overseas and I talked to all the military commanders, and as soon as they knew I was from West Virginia, they made a point to look me up to say, let me just tell you about the troops you send me from West Virginia. My chest was bursting with pride because I knew that, okay? But then to have them reconfirm it was really something special. You take all that in consideration, Glenn, and where we are and what we support. What we have done and the results that we give this nation for the amount of investment they've made, there's no way they said, well, we're just going to cut here and cut there. Find out who's performing. Let's just take out of theater, we take some of the equipment that comes out of theater. I'll use the Humvee because that's something everyone knows about. We bring them back, we refurbish them. We make them, we put the armor to them, we do them and do them right. And we do it for a lot less cost than they could to have them contracted out. It keeps all military people working. It keeps basically West Virginia creating value to this. When they said they're going to take the C-5As out, and they brought the Super Fortresses in, mm-hmm. That's because of the support that we have and basically the readiness of the aircraft that we're given. Right. Same as our C-130s up here. So we have performed. If another National Guard has not, or another base has not performed, okay, then they should have to either defend themselves or face the consequences. I've just said, make sure that you're basing your decisions on facts mm-hmm. and who's performing. I think we'll always do extremely well and we'll protect the jobs that we have and really the way we support our military.
You know, we probably have a lot of military families watching the show. What have you been able, or, you know, and I know you get asked a lot of times to welcome our troops home, but you also get asked when we're getting ready to send our troops out. What do you tell the not only the troopers getting ready to leave, but also the family members?
The main thing is we build up a support for the families. And General Tackett, his beautiful wife, Sally, what they did was next to none. I mean, the support they gave, the love and the caring and the nurturing, and what General Hoyer is doing and his staff now, that's the most important thing because, you know, when they leave, that's the day and we're all up there in fanfare right. and everything. But then the families have to go on and continue on without their loved one. And then the agony of not knowing, God forbid, they're in harm's way, something could happen. You have all of that. So we had to make sure that that was in place. And I think we've done that as well. Our National Guard has done it better than most National Guards. And the support. We had to make sure financially that was a priority for us. So when I did the budget as governor, I always made sure that our children, our families, our seniors, and our veterans were taken care of. Yep. And if we didn't do that and take care of our military who are defending us, who are we as a country? Mm-hmm. And I think that's why. So, and then when you have an unfortunate situation and a tragedy, you lose a service person. That's the toughest of all.
It is.
When you have to go to a funeral.
It is. And then the last question I'd have on this is, where do you see the U.S. going in supporting our troops when they come home? And I don't necessarily mean, and I know the job effort, but a lot of these guys, when they come back and they've been in theater for three or four tours, unfortunately, a lot of times, that's been a very stressful time, and the support that they need sometimes in order to...
Glenn, the PTS, post-traumatic syndrome, can you imagine being in an atmosphere not knowing really who the enemy is? Mm-hmm. And then you're supposed to be training people to take over their own destiny, and they could turn on you tomorrow and attack you? Mm-hmm. If you have that stress 24/7 for a 6-month tour, a year tour, whatever it takes a toll, mm-hmm. and some of the things they see is undescribable, and very few of them will talk about it, mm-hmm. but it's affecting them, and it affects the family and the family relationship. It affects their job and ability to do their job. We have got to make sure that we do everything as a country to make sure that we're assisting them to help them get back to as much of a normal life as they possibly can, and that's a tremendous commitment. And there's just so much more needs to be done. The VA hospitals are doing great. They're putting more people of help in that arena. Mm-hmm. And there's so much more. And we're going to see many more. We've got 100,000 or more coming home.
Yep. Unbelievable. Yeah. Well, we began the program talking about I Hire Veterans. People watching this, they can contact your office.
Yes. Really get on the web. It's manchin.senate.gov.
Okay.
And get more information and get and get the logo.
Get this. So we start seeing these pop up.
You're going to start seeing them. And I would say to all of you, when you see the I hire a veteran, it's very simple, I hire a veteran, you ought to go in and thank that employee, thank that government agent, thank that political person mm-hmm. who basically made a commitment to do that. And hopefully, I've told them this, you'll be better as a human being and as an American for doing it, and your business will flourish also.
Senator, I appreciate you taking time to talk with us about this program. Always good. Thank you.
Thank you, buddy.